My name is Maya Morales, and I'm an educator at the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County. Today, our educators are going to be sharing videos of Latinx culture throughout Los Angeles history, and we're going to talk about how Latinx people have shaped the city of Los Angeles, how we've created spaces and symbols where our heritage and culture can really thrive.
When you think about the birthplace of a city, where does your mind take you? Perhaps you think about your hometown. And if your hometown is the city of Los Angeles, then maybe you'll recall a street near some railroad tracks and City Hall. Olvera Street is an iconic location in Los Angeles, perhaps bringing to mind symbolic representation of Mexican culture. But how much do you know about the transformative history of this place, the people who inhabited it, and the ever-changing symbolism of it that has spanned for generations?
Let's begin with the year 1781, when a group of 11 families traveling from Mission San Gabriel settled along the Porciúncula River, a site of the largest established Tongva village, Yamna. This group of families is widely regarded as los pobladores, and these were the people who established the original pueblo under the colonization of California by Spain. Under Spanish rule, many of the indigenous peoples, the Tongva, who lived here, were forced to change their way of life, and much of their culture was destroyed as they were forced to work in the missions like San Gabriel and San Fernando. The settled area is widely known as the original pueblo, otherwise known as the original birthplace of Los Angeles, and it was named El Pueblo de Nuestra Señora de Los Angeles. Locations like Los Angeles become beacons for up-and-coming locales, and when that happens, the original inhabitants of the land become misinterpreted or even made up. We see the beginnings of these myths right at the original pueblo as artists and writers come to California and describe a mission myth of a romanticized Mexican colony thriving in Southern California. In 1884, author Helen Hunt Jackson published a book entitled Ramona, and it was about a Native American woman who suffered racial mistreatment in a post-Mexican-American War California setting. Her intention was to spread awareness about the mistreatment of indigenous peoples throughout history. However, Americans who were reading this book at the time were more widely drawn to the depictions of ranchero life in California. They saw it as beautiful and romantic. Further perpetuating this was Charles Loomis, who was an editor at the Los Angeles Times. Loomis had a vision of mission lifestyle as benevolent priests who were bringing culture and class to the indigenous peoples who originally inhabited this land. So he set out to restore all of the California missions that had fallen into disrepair after the Mexican-American War. This interpretation of history is damaging to an entire group of people. And in relating to and engaging in these myths, we see society falling prey to cultural appropriation as well as perpetuating racist and colonist ideologies. We know the truth of these histories because of the voices of resistance by the people who were harmed. Yet, as history takes its course, Los Angeles will undergo further reincarnations of its identity, and Olvera Street will have another dramatic misinterpretation of life on the pueblo. Imagine brightly colored buildings, music, dancing, and food. All of these themes are depicted in early paintings of Southern California and of Los Angeles, and artists would often meticulously document the customs and the costumes of California culture happening at the time in order to tap into these paintings and create these romantic ideas of what was happening in Southern California. All of this helped create a new myth for Los Angeles. LA's Spanish past. In the 1930s, a socialite named Christine Sterling set out to create a Mexican marketplace in the site of the original pueblo. Her vision was to really romanticize what this Mexican village would look like. So she had vendors and musicians dressing up in traditional costumes to sell their goods, and this idea kind of fed into a romantic Spanish outpost. As Sterling and other city leaders were creating this fantasy tourist destination, during this time, Mexican Americans were actually being deported. So we have this idea of bringing tourists over to Los Angeles to see this Mexican marketplace, but actual Mexican Americans were being forced to go back to Mexico through the Repatriation Act, even though about 60% of those who were deported were actually US-born citizens. While Sterling's efforts were to create and restore a historical spot in Los Angeles, for better or for worse, the original Pueblo was saved from falling into disrepair or even being bulldozed over to create a new neighborhood. And as you walk around today, you will see this birthplace of a city in its symbolic, most symbolic form. But you'll also see that it's a resource for the people who live here and for anyone who wants to come here and learn about Latinx heritage here in the city. You can look through those colorful vendors and stalls to see museums, research centers, learning centers, anything to kind of help you understand more about the context and the culture of Latinxes here in Los Angeles. On behalf of the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County, I want to say thank you all so much for joining me today.